There is no such thing as finding happiness by looking for it directly. It must come, if it comes at all, indirectly or by the love, service and happiness we give others. You're on the Happiness Project and I'm Dhanya. Anshu Gupta has ventured into a territory which no other voluntary organization has focused upon. The idea of clothing as a basic right. Even as his organization grows into 23 states, Kerala being the latest, he sticks to his basic belief of providing where it's required and respecting the dignity of the person who receives. Let's welcome Ramon Magsaysay Award winner and founder director of Goonj, Anshu Gupta, to the Happiness Project. Welcome to the Happiness Project, Anshu.
Thank you.
I'm so glad you could make it. The first time I heard of Goonj, when the floods were happening and there was a lot of action happening between the ladies in my group, and Goonj kept popping up. Goonj ta raha, whatever. And I was wondering, which is this organization? Why are people talking about this organization with so much of credibility and faith? And that's when I heard that there has been a lot of action that has been happening across the country with Goonj. So I'm really, really proud, happy and honored to have you on the show, Anshu. Goonj is active in more than 22 states and Kerala is your last state, I mean latest one, 23rd, right? Yeah. How would you differentiate Kerala from the rest of the country?
A very important part is that it is comparatively a smaller state. Okay. The terrain is much better. I mean, if you see when we were handling Uttarakhand, right, or even Jammu and Kashmir,
okay,
in the if I just talk about disasters of the last 5-6 years, that way terrain is, you know, much easier here, and it's a small state. It also has larger number of well-to-do people, systems, and you know, every year when a disaster happens, you are also equipped with better technology and all, because that the other part which helps in handling these things is also progressing very well.
Yeah.
So I remember when Uttarakhand we were handling it, and it was one of the toughest thing for us, because every day the landslide is happening. I mean, I remember why we were able to reach to the farthest places, because we literally operated like the army, where we said that the truck guy will not be paid on the basis of consignment.
Okay.
Because then they were not taking, because they get stuck. We said we will pay you on the basis of per day. But the basic brief is that you will start from one landslide and you will stop at another landslide. So next day when the landslide opens up, you should be the first person to move out.
Oh my right? God.
So all those strategical things we did. And that is the reason we were there with trucks load of material all across, absolutely in a very peaceful manner, no banner, no t-shirt. That's how Goonj operates. But we're there. But the communication was not there, because I'm talking about 5 years back.
Okay.
And in 5 years, a lot of things have in any case evolved.
Okay.
So otherwise, when I see the similarity, you have the same, you know, love of people, the hardcore volunteers from all across the life, which has happened in Chennai, which has happened in Uttarakhand, any other disaster.
Yes.
I mean, imagine in our case, there were 90 kids of the Social Work Institute from, say, Yavatmal, you know, coming all the way and spending so many days here, and those, you know, tiny little girls and boys lifting a bag of 25 kg, 35 kg.
Yeah.
So I think that's where the country unites.
Yeah.
And that's a very positive thing about this place. Not only Kerala, but this country, I would say.
But your other major initiative, not just a piece of cloth, would that kind of an initiative work in Kerala? Could you please describe that initiative in your own words, and also tell us if it is possible in Kerala?
So, answer to that is why not?
Okay.
The degree might be different, the scale might be different for sure. Okay. But
tell me about the initiative.
So, NJPC we call it, not just a piece of cloth, and because we are the people whom the half the country know that we collect and distribute clothes, which we don't, but we are known for raising or making clothing a matter of concern, because we said that you talk about three basic needs, you say food, cloth and shelter, and then cloth you just forget.
Completely, no. Yeah.
And cloth is not even a development issue, if you see the list of that. So that's where we entered,
okay,
the 6-7 units of personal clothing in way back in 1998. Hmm. Then while working on cloth, we raised another issue. We said that every single woman or girl needs a piece of cloth.
Hmm.
You call it sanitary pad, whatever today. But it's absolute basic need.
Okay.
If the people, a large number of people in the country and in the world do not have enough to wear, two women, single sari, common story.
Hmm.
Blouse, petticoat, extremely distant dream for millions.
Hmm.
You know? Also, for this particular purpose, during your menses, you need a cotton or semi-cotton cloth.
Correct.
But the financially weaker communities are surviving on the artificial fabric.
Yes.
So how do you really deal with it?
Yeah.
And can you imagine that in 2004-05, if you go on Google,
okay,
and type sanitary pad, sanitary napkin, there was no major study, no problem statement, no solution in this country for the 70% of the population, more than that.
Poverty-ridden, yeah.
For me and you, for our families, we have options, but not for those.
Not for them.
Not for those people.
So, what kind of options did they have? How do they manage?
So we actually, because we didn't find the information on Google, we started traveling.
Hmm.
And what we found is that they use the dirtiest piece of cloth because for them it's a synonym of dirt. Wash it, cannot dry it in sunlight.
Mm.
Then we also found that washing itself has become a problem because life depends on public taps.
Yes.
Public taps in the name of public convenience are always put up at a public
place. So they can't even wash it.
Absolutely. They can't even have a private place to take a bath. So how do you really wash that? Then we found that millions and millions of girls and women are actually using things like sand, ash, jute gunny bags, rugs, racks, newspaper, grass, dry leaf, used sanitary pad, newspaper, plastic sheet to cow dung.
To cow dung?
Any kind of dung actually. So, anything which can stop or absorb is used as a sanitary pad across the country. We have cases where, the turning point in our life was 2005 when we met a family and this lady shared that how she lost her sister or a relative who used a piece of blouse which had a hook and she died of tetanus.
Blouse had a hook.
The rusted
which led
hook.
To, the regular hook. Yeah.
Regular hook. So it's so grave. It is so grave. So that's where, so we were the first people to open up the subject and we said that the product is not the only solution. You really need to create awareness. You have to use that product as a tool. So that's where, so we started making it out of waste cloth, which we used to collect, cotton cloth, semi-cotton cloth. So we've done about 50 lakh pads, which are equivalent to almost 3 crore or plus, because every pad is, you can use it multiple times. It is 100% environment friendly because it is cotton, semi-cotton cloth. It has no iota of plastic. And it's also the cheapest possible pad because per usage cost goes down to a few paisa.
Okay, few paisa.
Few paisa because if it is like 2-3 rupees a pad, you use it 5 times, 6 times, so it is 40-50 paisa per usage.
Okay.
And no threat to the environment. That way. So that's what we are doing. And
in Kerala, do you see that kind of a need?
Listen, what we need to understand that unfortunately, the opinions and everything is created by people like me and you. And unfortunately, we wear the most distorted lenses because we have our own theories.
We have our own theories. Like I have my own theory.
Yeah. We have theories, we have arrogance
of
knowing everything.
Yes.
So that's what, in many lectures, I always tell people that in the hall where we sit, the hall which is made by someone on a piece of paper, that person is called a skilled. And the person who makes it brick by brick is called unskilled.
Correct.
Right? Because we want to keep ourselves on the top
pedestal. Yeah.
And people like us, then we start deciding things about the so-called unskilled, financially poor.
We assume things. Yes.
So I will not say that as of now, that the problem is absolutely same the way it exists in many other states.
Hmm.
But do remember a financially poor is poor, irrespective of the fact that which state that person lives. And the problems of the financially poor are same, irrespective of the state that person lives.
Absolutely. How did you feel about your award, Ramon Magsaysay Award, that you got? In fact, it's a dream for most of the people who work in the sector. This is the biggest acknowledgement that one can have, and you got it. How do you feel about it?
It's good. I think, it came as a surprise, for sure. And I think there are certain things in life which you only read about, and you feel good when you know that, you know, right from Mother Teresa to Pandit Ravi Shankar to Arun Shori.
You're in the league.
You get it. And if in that list, at the fag end of the list, if your name is also there in tiny point size, it's a beautiful feeling. And also, for sure, I think it is reaffirmation of lot of theories, lot of different kind of approaches which we have taken. And I remember when we started, lot of my friends and other people used to say in Hindi ki yadi kuch karna hai to dhanka kar, but if you really want to do something, so do something meaningful, because they thought that cloth is not a meaningful subject. But it is evolved with the love of family and hundreds of friends and volunteers and team. So it is evolved, and I remember, especially in Magsaysay,
when the name was announced and your name was announced, how did you come to know, and what was the immediate reaction like? Who told it to you?
So you get a call. Okay.
You knew that call was coming somehow?
No idea. No. So and it's a very, because now I'm also a part of the nomination group. You know, once you become an awardee.
Okay.
So you know that it's one of the most rigorous process of finding people.
Oh,
now,
really?
Now you know that.
Really.
And very beautifully they come, they spend time with you and whole lot of, and you don't even understand what is this happening. A whole lot of visitors keep coming, they also come. So you get a sudden call and you try to ignore that call.
You don't know what it is about.
How do you really do this, because there's no ITA, there's no application,
there's nothing.
Process. Huh. All of a sudden, suddenly a call comes on your mobile and someone informs you.
Huh.
So it was, and you have to keep that secret for a few days till it becomes public, because very humbly they ask you whether you will accept it or not.
Oh, wow. Yes. That would have been the moment,
yeah,
huh?
That
did your heart just skip a beat?
Yeah, I said, okay, how does it operate?
Meenakshi must have been extremely happy. She has been with you through, from the time Goonj was born, I guess the same year Urvi was born, your daughter as well. And you've been with her, she's been with you, a mutual support system through and through Goonj. How did Meenakshi feel about it?
So, Meenakshi is like backbone. Okay. Meenakshi is one of the most silent warrior of this entire journey. And also, I think a very big role to keep me on track. You know, because people like us can fly any day. You know, when 400
pulls
people,
you to the ground.
When 400 people stand and give you a standing ovation, who knows? It goes in your brain and you are finished that day.
That's true.
How, unfortunately, the human mind works.
Yeah.
So she has been able to keep us grounded, for sure. And then plus, you know, now I know that, so we operate like a family, huge family.
Okay.
We all sleep together, eat together when these kind of things happen.
You're staying in the same setup as the rest of the volunteers.
Same. Yeah. This is how it operates. I mean, but so many times, you know, I become the boss for the people who are personally inspired and they join the team.
Huh.
And then I become the boss. But Mini still remains a big friend. I mean, she still takes care of the listening about the boyfriends and the girlfriends of the
all those stories come to her.
so that's the role, and then obviously the strategy part, the communication part, because she has been with BBC for about a decade.
She left a BBC job to start Goonj, and you were also part of the corporate sector when you left the corporate sector and joined Goonj. It's a big jump.
So
what?
I left first, and I think that was a beautiful agreement that Meenakshi will earn and I'll spend.
Okay.
So for years that's how we operated. And then later on, after few
years, she realized that aise chhod nahi sakte, join to karna hi padega.
No, so she was a part of it and it was becoming too much for her, because the job at BBC was also very demanding.
Absolutely.
Goonj was growing.
Yeah.
Okay, and Urvi was also growing, and I was a useless father who was hardly doing anything for the family that way. So I think, so she took it for years, because earning was also important and I was not earning.
Yes.
Right? So she took it for really many years, and after that she left, and now she's totally merged into it.
A man who gives happiness and who gives dignity, and even in the face of a calamity, to people who need it. you know, help who need help. You don't like the word help yet. How do you see happiness? What is happiness to you?
I think I am just a very, very blessed person, you know, because very few people actually see a dream. And then it is further reduced when some people are able to work on it. And there are very few where the dream is in the right direction. Right? So for people like me, the dreams will never be fulfilled because every day it grows big. But the fact that it is in the right direction, I think that itself is such a huge blessing. And you know, a determination then obviously comes that there is so much to do. When ordinary people like us who come from very average middle class families can do a bit, you know, it is very encouraging. And it is, you know, I have actually written somewhere ki, in Hindi I had written this, ki main jeena nahi chahta hai kaam zindagi, chhodna chahta hu ek lakir. You know, I just want to leave that mark somewhere in life. And I think that God has been kind, the people have been really beautiful around me to make sure that I live my dream. What else?
I take away so many precious moments from this show by talking to you. Thank you so much for enriching me and my life here. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.